So in January 2011, I launched this magazine, Delayed Gratification, the slow journalist magazine. I have brought as many copies of it as I could fit in my backpack, which is 8. So if you'd like one, do come and grab one afterwards. The idea of the magazine was to provide a counterpoint and an antidote to super fast, speedy, 24/7 digital news production, that round-the-clock, Twitter-driven stuff that was starting to drive us all mad even back then. The idea was to do something that was the opposite of what seemed to be the new model for news. So instead of being digital-led, it was going to be print-first. Instead of reporting on the news as it was happening in real time, it was going to wait for 3 months, draw a line in the sand, return to the big stories with the benefit of hindsight, and ask the question of what happened next. And instead of being distributed for free and being monetized with invasive, aggressive digital advertising, it was going to be paid for by subscribers and be advertising free. So as part of this magazine, we've done lots and lots of beautiful long-form features. We send people out four corners of the world for weeks and months at a time to bring back beautiful investigative stories. We do lots of photo features, but also, since the very first issue, we've done loads and loads and loads of infographics. And those are the things that cut through for us online. So this is just the most visited pages over the last year on our website. These are the ones where we sent people, journalists, sometimes into very tricky and awkward situations to bring back beautiful long-form stories, 6,000-7,000 words, sort of thing that editors get really, really excited about. And these are infographics. Infographics is absolutely massive for us. And given that we sell the vast majority of our magazines through our online website, they've been brilliant in driving traffic for us. They've been great as well because they've enabled us to go and teach in lots of big organizations and make lots of infographics for big organizations, which has been brilliant for helping us to invest in some really, really good journalism. So what I'm going to do is, in the time that's left to me, is I'm going to condense some of the most important, I think, lessons that we teach in these classes and do it through the means of showing you lots and lots of beautiful infographics. And incidentally, I will be around afterwards. If anyone wants to come and talk about any particular infographics or dataviz things that they're talking about, then come over and find me. We'll have a little elbow bump and a chat. So this is the first infographic of ours that went viral online. It's called Plot Lines, and it looks like this. So Plot Lines is just a graphic representation of the editorial themes of the Booker Prize longlist. This is back in 2011. Thought Booker Prize was a nice one to show, given that you have Bernardine Evaristo coming to speak tomorrow. Very exciting. So what we did for this is we just took 5 big book reviewing publications. We took their reviews of these novels. We went through and we stripped out all of the mentions of editorial themes, and then we condensed them, and then we put it together into this. So editorial themes like a mysterious letter, corruption and theft, death, nanny trust issues, totalitarian Bucharest, and war. And we put it out online. And I've always been abysmal at Twitter. And I put it out online with a message that said something like, "Hello, the internet. I've made an infographic. Click on the link below and you can access the aforementioned infographic." Nobody cared. And then somebody, some bright spark out there, bless them, changed the message to, "Want to be on the Booker Prize long list? Write about death." And we saw that infographic swirl around the world. We saw this message being translated into multiple different languages, channel tons and tons of people to our site, and sell us lots of print magazines, which is how we make money. So we did that again the following year. And the following year, the biggest segment was not death, but sex. So I knew what to do. Want to be longlisted for the Booker Prize? Write about sex. Took off again. Not quite as viral, but took off again. Now, I know that I'm standing in front of a room full of analysts. So you'll already probably be thinking this, but there was something that really bothered me about this infographic, which is that the methodology rested on some pretty subjective assumptions. Like, you know, what novel doesn't have death in it in some form? And what sort of death are we talking about? Death of characters? Death of the soul? Death of civilization? Most novels are rancid with death at some level. So the next year, I decided to go completely objective. I looked at the sort of people modally speaking, who had won the Booker Prize, going right the way back to the very first one, I think in 1969. So modally speaking, the winners, to be a winner, you'll be a man in your 50s, born in England, writing a fourth book about a man from the present day, set in England, whose narrative begins in the third person, runs the less than 400 pages, and with a cover that is an illustration. And they put it out online. Nobody cared. It was an underwhelming and dispiriting answer to a question that nobody was asking themselves. In fact, the only thing that I really kind of took from it after all of that effort was this lovely fact up there in the top right-hand corner, which is if you take the Amazon rankings of the Booker Prize-winning novels back to 1969, the average is 59,803. This prize is no guarantee of long-term commercial success. This is the first infographic that we won an Information is Beautiful award for. And it takes exactly the same premise, but it applies to a question that people do ask themselves, which is when Oscar season comes around, they ask themselves, what sort of character should you play in order to win a leading man or a leading lady Oscar? So we went all the way back to the first ones in 1928, and we found out that, modally speaking, if you're going to win, you'll play a fictional character who's North American, from the present day if you're a man, from the recent past if you're a woman, who works as a soldier, a lawman, a monarch, a politician, if you're a man, how depressing is this, who works as a performer, a housewife, a mother, a socialite, a service industry type, or a prostitute slash escort, if you're a woman, who participates in no sexual scenes, and who, in the end, does not die on screen. And what we've done every year since then, so we've updated it each year, but what we've done in the run-up to Oscars is we've taken the list of nominations, we've run it, reverse run it through this, to see if it kind of projects it. You know, I understand it's not the tightest of analysis, but it's fun, and sometimes we get it right. And then we did some nice, interesting bits of analysis. So we looked at facial hair. In fact, this spreadsheet was absolutely gigantic, and the person who compiled it for us, we had them looking at hair color. And they came to me about halfway through, and they're like, look, I've got back to the 1960s, and it's all in black and white. I have no idea. It's fine. We'll drop that. But we did look at facial hair. So for the men, 17% of winners had a moustache, 18% had a beard. Best decade for face fuzz, unsurprisingly, the 1970s. Now, this infographic I show you, not because it's one of our best, because it is the single worst infographic we have made in the last 10 years, but is the one that taught us, I think, probably the most about how to make beautiful data visualizations. It's called Every Victoria Cross Ever Awarded. Each of these bubbles here represents a recipient of the Victoria Cross going right the way back to the first one in the Crimean War in 1853. They have their initials in the bubbles. They are color-coded by the branch of the armed services that they served in. They are smaller if they're soldiers, seamen, or airmen, and they're larger if they're officer class. There's black bubbles in the middle of the posthumous ones. There's different colors for chaplains who've won it and things like that, and the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. And finally, they're broken down chronologically, so each of those numbers represents a war campaign or expedition fought in by the British since 1853. And it was one of those ones, and I don't know if you have this feeling ever, but it was getting close to the deadline, getting close to having to go to press, and we'd all poured a huge amount of work into this. And we were having conversations like, I like the Victoria Cross infographic. Do you like it? Oh, I like it. Do you like it? And we sort of chickened ourselves basically into publishing this awful thing. And the daft thing was that actually in all of that wall of data with no way into it, there were tons of great stories. You could have broken it down by the branches of the armed forces. You could have looked at the various different wars. The thing that I want to do one of these days is just simply take this thing in the bottom right-hand corner, the wars, campaigns, and expeditions, and I just want to track it on a simple timeline, because I think you would see immediately that the British are an incredibly warlike nation who have been fighting with somebody more or less non-stop since 1853. However, the lovely thing about this is it brings me to one of two insights that I would like to share with you today. It may be obvious, but I think it bears repeating, which is this: there are no good infographics without good stories. We see so much time and money and marketing energy and expense being wasted on infographics that don't catch on and that don't engage with people because they don't contain a relatable human story at their heart. Here's my other insight for you. There are only five types of infographic. There's only five types of infographic in the same way as there's only seven types of Hollywood plot. And actually, if you know what they are, it's a lovely shortcut to working out the best data presentation for your data set. So I'm going to rattle through them, show you some examples. The five types: illustrative, proportional, map, timeline, and list. And I think any single data visualization you find will either be one of these or a combination of these together. So illustrative, just simply a lovely illustration with a fact. Here's a couple of nice ones. So we spotted a couple of years ago that Manchester City had spent £307 million on its defense since the start of the 2016-17 season. We're looking for a nice number to put that up against. So we thought we'd put it in terms of countries, and we worked out that the country of Georgia, which was undergoing encroachment for Russia at the time, spent significantly less at £239 million. So a couple of nice stats, a very simple illustration split down the middle, and suddenly you've got something that will enliven a report or a story or give those people who are standing at the newsstand, surrounded by billions of magazines, flicking through this one, saying, £10, a reason to pick it up and engage with it, because it's not the long-form stories that you see them engaging with. Here's another nice one, you versus Denise Coates. Denise Coates. So Denise Coates is the multi-billionaire founder and co-CEO of Bet365. She received compensation of £265 million for her work in 2017. So we just tried to put that in context. If you're taking home the UK's average salary, that's 9,864 times more than you. And so we're trying to look for a way to put that in context. So if Denise buys, if you buy a pint of milk, that's equivalent of her buying, in terms of percentage of her income, four magnums of Mouettes Chandon's Dom Perignon P2 1993 vintage. You buy a McDonald's filet fish sandwich, delicious. And she buys 6 kilos of Imperial Beluga caviar. You treat yourself to an off-peak single from London to Milton Keynes and a cup of tea to cheer you on your way. She can take a trip to space on Virgin Galactic. You get a couple's annual art pass and a pack of crayons. And she can buy Banksy's Girl with Balloon. And finally, you get two top-tier Spurs season tickets. She can buy Sunderland Football Club. So illustrative is best if the story that you're trying to do is about highlighting a single fact or statistic or giving the reader a way in to your presentation, to your report, to something broader online. These are the tend to be things that tend to be honey traps online for us. Proportional. We talk a lot in the office about the idea of the wordless infographic, and the idea that the perfect infographic wouldn't need any words on it at all because it would so be brilliantly designed. Here's a basher, a wordless infographic. So you've got proportionality and you've got a key next to it. Does anybody want to hazard a guess about what this infographic's about? Copy the magazine to anyone who can get it. It could be, it's not. It's definitely about the body. No, do you know what? This is entirely unfair. And also, I'm quite glad that, you know, it's not possible to do it without words because I'm an editor. So this is about injuries on fireworks night. So the most injured parts of the body on fireworks night, the hands, followed by the head, followed by the torso, followed by the eyes, followed by the legs, followed by the arms. Here's one that does have words on it. So a simple proportionality renders a tree map. And this was just a fun thing. There's this annual issue of Vogue, the fashion issue. I never really kind of understood because it seems to me that every issue of Vogue is the fashion issue. But the big September issue, the one that they make the film about. And we thought, wouldn't it be interesting to work out how much it would cost to buy everything in that massive, great, big issue of Vogue? So we sat down, we disregarded all of the adverts and anything that didn't have a price by it, but we added up every single editorially recommended product with a price. And worked out that at that time, a few years ago now, in order to buy everything in that issue of Vogue, you'd have to pay £638,713, which at the time was gratifyingly close to $1 million. And then for purposes of comparison, we had GQ, and then we could do some lovely breakdowns within it. So within the dresses and skirts section, you've got an embroidered silk maxi dress from Dior for £26,000. This is my favorite thing. There's £3,654 spent on ponchos. So just kind of a nice proportionality allows you to compare between the two different things. Also, my absolute favorite fact on there, anyone want to take a guess about how many advertising pages you have to make your way through before you get to the first editorial page in the September issue of Vogue? More? 45. 80! And it's gone up since then. The last one was over 100. He was like, oh. but it's not surprising because it weighs 1.26 kilos. So proportionality you'll reach for if the heart of your story is about numerical comparison and giving context to your data. Maps. We have a sort of a shorthand in the office for talking about map-based infographics. And we tend to shy away from them because Russia always wins. And we see so many infographics being made, and you know, it's a story about Europe or it's about the world, and you know, the obvious thing to do is to take the countries of the world, get yourself a vector map of them, and then color code them, so do a kind of a heat map about them. But the problem is that the eye doesn't see the colors, the eye just sees how gigantic Russia is. So in general, we steer clear of maps on their own terms, unless they're used in conjunction with something else to give a visual cue to say this is a story about Europe and then to add in proportionality. Here's one example where it did work, though, I think. So we were looking at the last UK census, and my absolute favourite bit of information in there was about the people who ticked the no religion box. So kind of going through screeds and screeds and screeds of this census. And so we had some per capita analysis, just looking at the most divine cities in the country, and the most damned, so the most divine with the smallest percentage of people ticking no religion, and the most damned with those ticking the greatest amount. So I had these two lists, and I took them to our art director, and I said, I can see this infographic. It's a double-page spread. At the heart of it is a twirling vortex. You've got these tiny figures being flown up towards heaven, and they're sprouting wings, and they've got harps. And on the other side, you've got these characters being flung down towards the fiery abyss, and they're sprouting horns, and they've got tridents. And crucially, in their other hand, they're holding something that is indicative of the town they're from. And the art director said, no. He said, quite apart from anything else, yes, you've got some coal with Merthyr Tydfil or something like that, but how are you going to represent Bridgend? So I said, okay, fine. He said, but look, let's just put it on a map and see what happens. And we did, and this fascinating additional story came out, which is not immediately visible with the lists, which is that you have this cluster of non-believers in the post-industrialized towns of the north, which have seen relatively high levels of immigration, and this sort of swathe of non-believers in Wales and in the south and out to the east, where you've seen relatively very low levels of immigration. So that's interesting, and I think another thing that is always nice in infographics, as a kind of an additional thought, is it's always lovely if you can allow people to find themselves in the data. So I think the first instinct, actually we could have just put up those lists, the first instinct is to look for your town, or to look for a town where someone you live is, or whatever. And then you've got this nice additional thing. So I would say maps, best for geographic patterns, probably very little else if used just on their own. Timeline. Here's another wordless data visualization. It's not actually wordless, it's got one word on it. What's this one about? Yes, it's the tallest building in the world, and how long it was the tallest building in the world for. And originally what we had was we had the tallest buildings in the world over time, and we just had them as a simple bar chart, just showing the kind of them going up, and actually relatively small changes. There were some nice bits where there was one that was taller, and then the next one was smaller because the cathedral had burnt down, and then kind of went on like that. And that's how we did it in the magazine. But then we were looking at it afterwards, and we're thinking, I'm not sure that that's actually the heart of this story. I think the heart of this story is that the Great Pyramid of Giza was the tallest building in the world for 4,061 years. It just goes on and on and on and on and on. And then you have this nice additional thing you can put on some nice little icons, and so you can see the kind of the uses of the buildings changing. Religious. Symbols of national pride, communications, commercial, and then the Burj Khalifa, which I guess is probably a combination of all of these. And actually, in our next issue, which is going to press tomorrow night, we have a 12-page infographic spectacular on China. So we're looking at how China has changed in the last 20 years. And as part of it, we've got a thing about the tallest buildings in China. And something like six of the top 10 tallest buildings in the world currently are in China. So timeline is best if the heart of your story is about change over time, history, flow, path, process, or if you're projecting into the future. And this is the spine that you'll reach for if that's the heart of your story. Finally, list. A lot of people, I think, would overlook this as an infographic formula, but it can be incredibly powerful, particularly if you have a lot of data to convey. So here's a slightly tongue-in-cheek thing that we do most years called the best country in the world. We take a bunch of indices that look at things like press freedom, social progress, peace, good countryness, prosperity, democracy, happiness, and the gender gap. And we take the top 10 and bottom 10 nations. We give them a weighted score, and then we come up with our DG aggregated top 10 and worst 10 countries in the world. It's actually incredibly simple. This is the sort of thing that you can actually make in Excel or PowerPoint, and we've actually done it in PowerPoint just to prove that. It's not quite as nice, but you can do it. And so it's just a series of lists, a little bit of iconography at the top to give you a visual shorthand, and then this nice color coding that just kind of allows you to move your way through, find a country and sort of trace your way through. And then some proportionality at the bottom, comparing the best country in the world, Norway, with the worst country in the world, Yemen, in terms of population, GDP per capita, infant mortality, and so on and so forth. List, best for showing rankings, highlighting commonality, and categorization. And finally, just before some questions, as I said, it's very rare that you would use one of these just on its own. You know, you might use an illustrative thing just to kind of draw people in. But the really exciting ones come from combination. So when we were covering the truly horrific attack in Las Vegas, this gunman, Stephen Paddock, in Las Vegas, shooting down into a crowd in October 2017, we pulled it together into this infographic. So this infographic, it's got a timeline at the heart of it. This is, we've got the data for mass shootings in the US over 2017. And so you have a timeline running through the months of the year. You have proportionality, showing the number of people killed in these mass shootings. There's some fascinating extra stuff that we pulled out separately. The largest number of days between mass shootings in 2017 in the States was 5 days, pitifully small. And this massive, great big line coming off here, this is the attack. And it's so massive that we weren't actually able to fit it within the confines of a double page spread in the magazine. Then you've got a map, a stylized map, at the center of the states, showing states where there were and were not mass shootings over that period. I think this works in terms of a map because the proportionality is there because you've stylized it, so you've equalized all the states. And it still gives you kind of a nice feeling and a visual shorthand as well. And then a little bit of illustration here, just with the stick men and a little timeline there. I'll show you also, so when we had this on show at our events, we like to do lots of slow journalism nights. Do come along, we get good people. Last one was Ian Hislop. We like to have an infographics gallery up on the wall. And this is what we put up on the wall with the full length of that October shooting. So that was printed out there, and this line just continued all the way across the wall. And it was an incredibly striking piece of data visualization, lots of people kind of stopping and really kind of brought it home to life. Fantastic, that's my insights wrapped up. I think we've got time for a couple of questions before lunch.
Thank you so much, Rob. I'm a long-time subscriber, and I would thoroughly recommend popping on to Delayed Gratification to subscribe. We have had a couple of questions. The first one I'm going to turn to is from Danny Russell, who's going to be upstairs, I think, later on doing the Applied Intelligence Zone. But he was saying, you know, 10 years on from McCandless's superb TED Talk, why is it that brilliant infographics are so rare in the business world? I mean, you come from a world of content creation and editorialization. So you love to immerse yourself in it, but why is it we don't see more of this kind of stuff out in the world that's full of data, as we've been hearing about this morning?
That's a very good question. So we have made a lot of infographics for big companies, and we make, you know, really interesting big things like that. I guess we've been very lucky with the people that we have made infographics for, insofar as they've allowed us to be part of the process of looking at the data and working out what we think will be a compelling story for people. And I think the problem often comes when we teach. A lot of people say to us, this is all very well, and it's nice to be able to make these things, but that's not what I'm tasked with doing. Day in, day out, I am tasked with turning the wheel on these particular reports and so on. So one of the things that we try to talk to people about is to kind of give them the tools to go to the people that they're working for and say, look, it's all very well, and I can keep doing this, but if you're asking me to do this and to make something that might be viral, or that might be engaged with, or that might drive us new business or whatever, that's probably not the best approach. Probably the best approach is to start with a story that is the sort of story I'd be interested in hearing down the pub, and then to work out how to reconstruct it and whether the data's there to support it. So I think I am surprised, actually. I'm kind of surprised that the vogue for infographics is still going on. We keep thinking that we've kind of crested the wave and that it's all kind of over, and I guess it may come down with a bang before long. But it's still interesting that a lot of the infographics tools that are being used, you know, the kind of the tools that you can sign up for online, they're still doing pretty basic stuff. It still looks quite templated and not very sophisticated.
And you've talked about the storytelling. We've been hearing earlier about mixing the anecdotal with the kind of big data side to try and come up with something that's a little bit more balanced. But that's really what you're talking about, isn't it? It's finding the story first, then looking at your data sets. Because that's one of the other questions here is gosh, you know, how do you choose the data set for where you're going to find a story in the first place?
I think it can be either. So I think you could go into a data set thinking, right, this is a story that I'm interested in finding, and you can see whether it's there or not. But you can also go into a data set with a set of principles about what sort of things make for interesting stories. So outliers, averages and divergence from the averages, comparison of demographic sets and so on. And then you can apply that and see whether there are compelling stories in there.
Yeah, and I guess the other thing is that when you talk about virality, a lot of people in the room will be most concerned about engagement with decision makers, about influencing people. Yeah. Do you think that there is a kind of influence that you've had through the presentation of data? I'm particularly taken with the Las Vegas shooter one, because you can't look at that without feeling an emotional response, I think.
Yeah, so it's we're like an avowedly old-fashioned company, doggedly, obstinately old-fashioned. So we don't really kind of canvas our readers very much. I'm not entirely sure who our readers are. sort of speak to them at events, they seem to be very nice. But we had this kind of idea that everybody's constantly trying to sort of be your best mate, particularly online, and find out, you know, like ask you to come up with a slogan for their toilet paper, whatever it might be. So the idea is, you know, come through your letterbox once every 3 months, if you like it, that's great. It's not a great business model, to be honest with you, but that's one we pursued. So all I can go off is engagement in terms of people getting in touch and saying, oh yes, you know, we really like this. And you do get spikes. One of the best things we ever did in terms of engagement, we got any Alan Partridge fans in the house at all? Yeah, fantastic. So you'll love this. So when the Alpha Papa film came out, we decided we were going to do an epic Alan Partridge infographic. And we used as our sort of our way in that classic scene where Alan Partridge is at an Italian restaurant at the BBC with Tony Hayes, the head of BBC commissioning, and he's just been told he's not getting a second season. And he plunges his fork into a wheel of Stilton on a cheese trolley that's going by, and he waves it in Tony Hayes' face, and he says, "Smell my cheese!" And he runs out in floods of tears. And he goes to the car park, and his long-suffering PA, Lynn, is there, and she says, "How did it go?" And he said, "Not well. I needed a positive, and I got a negative. Now I need two positives. One to make up for the negative, or one just so I got positive." So we looked at everything that Alan Partridge has done, with like all of the radio shows, the TV shows, the Foster specials, the Mid-Morning Matters. We looked at the two autobiographies, the film, the appearance on Comic Relief. It's all this universe that fits together. And we wrote down every good and bad thing that had ever happened to Alan Partridge. So good things like he becomes best friends with Gary Barlow at one point, and bad things like he becomes addicted to Toblerone. And then we kind of charted it all out from his birth, up and down, all the kind of ups and downs. We worked out that at the end, Alan needed 143 positives, 142 to make up for the negatives, and one just so he had a positive. And the response we had from that was amazing, because the people who loved it really loved it, and they could see the effort just kind of reeking off the page at a satisfying conclusion. And, you know, I send journalists to scary places, and we've just had somebody get back from 3 weeks on the border between Uganda and DRC, and every night, not being a brave enough man to go myself, I just agonize and pester them over WhatsApp and stuff like that. I get nowhere near this sort of reaction to stories like that that are properly invested. But an Alan Partridge thing like that, that really kind of got it. So I think maybe in terms of engagement, one of the things, apart from a satisfying story, is just to see evidence of effort. It was over 4 pages as well, and it was the longest we'd ever done until this latest issue, when we did our first ever double gatefold on the Beatles. So we tracked every single song released by the Beatles and how it went down, so we could definitively answer who the best singer and songwriter were in the Beatles.
Now, if your research project needs that kind of engagement and the analysis of that level of data, because I'm sure you will have big data sets to play with, Rob is definitely your man. Thank you so much indeed, Rob Otter. Thank you.